This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, come on, people of God. This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
All right. Welcome to this service of worship. Welcome to Morning Song as we gather in this beautiful space to give thanks to God, to join together, to be strengthened in our life together for Christ. So let us worship God.
All right, Rafe is going to open this up with us. It's Start a Fire. We hope we can start a fire in your heart this morning.
Sing this with us, y'all.
Well, the world can be cold and bitter. Feels like we're in a dead of winter, waiting on something better. Am I really gonna hide forever? Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. Let your light shine, let your light shine for all to see. Start a fire in my soul.
So brightly, so everyone around can see that it's you.
Let us join together in prayer. O Lord our God, creator of heaven and earth, we lift our hearts to you in praise. We give you thanks for the beauty of the earth, for the changing of colors on a fall day, for the work of your Holy Spirit in our lives, for you come to us, you quicken us, you make us alive, you fill us with grace and love and peace. So, Lord, as we come to worship you, may we lift our voices in songs of praise. May we hear your words spoken, and may we respond with transformed lives. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
We're going to start this morning with a song that we've sung for a long, long time. Beautiful way to start our praise and worship. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. Will you all stand and sing with us?
To me, save that thou art. You may be seated. We come to this time and place of worship, knowing our own need of God's grace and seeking God's grace and forgiveness. So, trusting in the promises of our Lord, let us join together in our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we have not lived as Jesus lived. In the light of Christ, we see our sin. We compromise our values, failing to live as followers of Jesus. We fail to love others, choosing instead to live in darkness of fear, suspicion, and anger. We nurse old wounds, scorning forgiveness and holding grudges against others. Cleanse us and make us new so that we may walk in the light of Christ. Holy God, we lay our sins before you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Amen. Friends, we have been called, claimed, forgiven, and made new by God, the creator and sustainer of all things. Thanks be to God, and amen. Friends, because God has given us the grace of forgiveness, we have that grace to share one another and are indeed called to share that grace with one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with the peace of Christ.
It's so good to be here together in this beautiful space with wonderful folks to worship together with in the name of the Lord. We would love for you to make your presence known and invite you to circulate the friendship pads. And if there's not one on your in your chair row, please reach out and grab one from another. It's so good to be together. And if you're worshiping with us online, we encourage you to make your presence known either on our website, www.fpcspartanburg.org/worship, or on the Shelby app. And it's good to gather together in God's house. The blood drive is taking place today, and they welcome walk-ins. So we receive a $20 donation for everyone who donates, and those are used for special projects in the church and the community. And you can also get antibody testing today free. And you can get a t-shirt, either a Carolina or a Clemson t-shirt. So hurry before all the Carolina ones run out. Yeah, I thought so. You're invited to join a Zoom Echoes class as caregiver support group this Thursday evening at 7 p.m. And you want to contact Joni here at the church if you'd like to have the link. And it's a very interesting class because the special speaker is Dory Burgess, the director of the local Alzheimer's Association chapter. So if you have questions about Alzheimer's, it would be a great opportunity for you. Wednesday's at First Italian Week. Sign up by noon tomorrow. And if you're interested in uniting with the church, please go to the Perrin Room at 10:30 this morning, and Reverend Joanne Hull and the elders will be glad to welcome you and receive you into the life of the church. We do want to extend our Christian love and sympathy to the families of two members of the church who entered the church triumphant. First, Ann Argo Sanders, the wife of Sandy Sanders, died on Tuesday, October 5th, and there will be a graveside service at 2 p.m. on Friday at Greenlawn. And also, we want to extend our sympathy to Naomi Taylor and the death of her husband, Hollis, who also died on October 5th, and there will be a service in the sanctuary on Saturday at 11 a.m. At this time, I would like to invite Elder Vic Bailey, the co-chair of our stewardship committee, to present a call to discipleship. Vic, welcome.
Good morning. In his cover letter in the October edition of First News, Lewis Galloway challenged every member of this congregation to consider our faithfulness and trustworthiness with the resources entrusted to us by God. As a congregation, our current giving levels simply do not keep pace with the needs of the church. Over the last few years, there have been budget cuts to the programs and mission efforts that have long been hallmarks of First Presbyterian Church. Now, we are preparing the way for a new senior pastor, youth minister, and children's director. We are preparing the way for this congregation to shine as an even brighter beacon of God's grace, love, and hope. As part of this preparation, each household must prayerfully consider what portion of their resources can be set aside to further God's kingdom. In response to the call to consider how our gifts can best be put to work for the glory of God, your church officers have made a very powerful statement. When asked to lead the way and make early pledges toward next year's church budget, your elders and deacons enthusiastically stood up, got on board, and made the commitment to prepare the way for the amazing things God has in store for First Presbyterian Church. Additionally, 100% of our pastors have made their pledges for 2022. We have not had this level of energy heading into a stewardship campaign in quite some time. God is at work in this place. In order to prepare the way and the church budget, the stewardship committee is asking each household to fill out a pledge card and turn it into the church prior to or during worship services next Sunday, October 17th. Your submitted pledge card will make a difference in the missions, ministries, fellowship opportunities, and recreation activities that this church offers in 2022. Your pledge will go to support this magnificent facility and the dedicated staff who work here each day. Your pledge will further the kingdom of God in Spartanburg and beyond. Thanks be to God for the many ways He has blessed this church and in turn used this church to bless so many. The best is yet to come. Let us prepare the way.
Thank you so much, Vic. And now I'd like to invite the children to come forward and join me in the front. Come on down. Hey, gang. Good morning. Hi. Come on down, gang. It's good to see all of you this morning. I want to ask you a question. We've got a few more friends coming. All right. We've got a few more. That's good. Hey, I want to ask you a question. Go on, come a little closer. Come on, scooch in. Yeah, you are. You are, Durham. Okay, I want to ask you, have you ever been sick? Raise your hand if you've been sick. You have been, has your stomach hurt or had a cold or maybe you fell and broke something or you had a fever?
Flu.
Flu, you had the flu. All kinds of things, right? So being sick is no fun. And when we're sick, it's wonderful that we have a dad or a mom who can help us, who, you know, tuck the covers just right and fluff your pillow and bring you something cool to drink or rub your back. What? Or bless you. And I want to talk about that part too in just a minute. And then we have nurses, if you really get sick, and a doctor who can help you. We even have hospitals, don't we? If you get, have any of you ever been to the hospital or not? Okay, well, there you go. So when we get really sick, we have all these wonderful things that help us. We have medicines, we have a dad, a mom, we have nurses, doctors. We have all kinds of things to help us. But you know the most important thing we have? You said the word, bless.
Yeah.
We have Jesus,
yeah,
who loves us, who wants us to be well, to be made whole and not to be sick. And so when we have all these other things, we also have prayer. And that's when we ask God to heal us and to bless us and to hold us. So no matter where we are, no matter what's happened to us, Jesus is there to love us, to hold us, to heal us. So when we get sick or somebody we love gets sick, we can pray and ask God to heal us. What was he going to say? Yeah, really? That's great. Yeah. Well, then we ask God to heal us. So let's have a prayer. All of us join.
Dear God,
we thank you for moms and dads,
and
nurses and doctors, and medicine and cool things to drink. But most of all, we thank you for Jesus, who loves us and heals us. Amen. Thank you. Now you can go back and be with your families. Thank you for coming up here and being with me. And now I want to invite Ramsey Neely to come forward and read the scripture for us.
A reading from Isaiah 61, 1 through 4. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations.
Thank you, Ramsey. Hear now the word of God from the Gospel of Mark, the second chapter, beginning at the first verse, the healing of the paralytic. When Jesus returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many gathered around there that there was no longer room for them, not even in front of the door, and he was speaking the word to them. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And after having dug through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak in this way? This is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" At once Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions among themselves. And he said to them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up, take your mat, and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before them all. And they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." This is the word of the Lord. When I hear the opening of this story from Mark's gospel, I wonder to myself, why doesn't Jesus see what's going on? He's at home in Capernaum, and so many people are there that you couldn't squeeze one more six-year-old into the house. People are spilling out of the door. And in the same town, there's a paralyzed man desperate to be healed. His friends care enough about him to carry him to the feet of Jesus, only they can't get in the house. They want to see if Jesus will do for him what Jesus has done for others. But no matter how hard they try, no matter how they push and shove and ask to get in front of others, they cannot get into the house to see Jesus. But these, thank God, are persistent and intuitive, inventive friends. They're the kind of friends we want to have at midnight when everything is going south. And so they go up on the roof and they begin to literally dig through that timber mud thatch roof and literally dig a hole into the roof until they're able to lower their paralyzed friend down on the stretcher to the very feet of Jesus. Bits of dust and mud and straw fall into the room, and the sunlight illuminates the dim interior of the room as the man is lowered by the ropes. And just when they expect Jesus to say, "Get up, walk," no. He says, "My son, your sins are forgiven." Can't Jesus see what's going on? Here is a man with a physical problem that's obvious to everyone else, and yet Jesus says, "My son, your sins are forgiven." You see the painting by the Italian artist Caravaggio? I wish that Caravaggio had painted this scene of the paralyzed man lowered to the feet of Jesus. You know this painting, perhaps. You see Jesus and Peter there, and the light is streaming from behind them across the faces of others down to the very figure of Matthew or Levi, who's hunched over a pile of coins, and it is the calling of St. Matthew by Jesus, the light in the room. Doesn't Jesus see what's going on? Caravaggio would have seen the light streaming down through the hole in the roof, filling the room. Why doesn't Jesus see what's going on? Here is a man who desperately needs to be healed, and all Jesus wants to talk about is the forgiveness of sins. Doesn't Jesus see what's going on in our churches, our community, our world, our ministries? It doesn't take a lot of insight to look around and to see the hurt, the brokenness, the paralysis of our world. As Christians, sometimes the hardest question we ever have to ask is, why doesn't God do something about so much suffering? And we are literally a world at war. Different cultures, political groups, religions eye each other with suspicion and hostility. And anyone who's ever delivered food or paid a utility bill or bought school supplies or dealt with abuse for other people in crisis can see the obvious difficulties that people in our world, our community are facing. It doesn't take a beam of light to highlight the trouble some people have in finding stable jobs, affordable housing, education, food, transportation, emotional stability. Why doesn't God do something about these visible, obvious problems? Maybe we're the ones who cannot see. Yes, a shaft of light illuminates the room, allowing the crowd, the skeptics, the paralyzed man, and even his friends who peer down from the roof to see what is going on. But as we enter into this room with Jesus, we see that the light is already there. If Caravaggio had painted this scene, the artist's eye would have seen that the light streaming down from the hole in the roof is not the only light illuminating the scene. He would have seen Jesus. Jesus, the one who is the light, who brings light into every life and into every space. And over the years, I've come to understand that as Christians, so much of our lives is about simply keeping our eyes on Jesus, the light of the world, and seeing everything and everyone through his light. For Jesus sees what we cannot see. He sees that our deepest need is peace with God, reconciliation with God. He understands that our deepest need is to be reconciled one to another and to live together in peace. What matters most is what we cannot see. And therefore, Jesus says to the paralytic, "My son, your sins are forgiven." Instead of first healing his paralysis, he heals the man's broken relationship with God and with others. But that spiritual healing causes a new problem to emerge. The scribes begin to murmur among themselves that Jesus has now spoken blasphemy. So which is easier, to say to the paralytic, "Rise, take up your mat and be healed," or to forgive sins? And to demonstrate his authority, his power to forgive sins, to bring about reconciliation between heaven and earth, between ourselves and God, he says to the paralytic, "Be healed. Pick up your pallet and go home." The proof of the power of Jesus to forgive sins is found in his power to heal the paralytic. And the amazed, astonished crowd glorifies God. "We've never seen anything like it," they say. And suddenly, they perceive that the true light is already in the room. And Jesus knows that our need for physical healing is only a small part of that greater need for our healing with God and with one another, the forgiveness of sins. The light reveals that our most pressing need is to live in the peace of the reign of God. I've shared with some of you before the story of Reynolds Price, that former Duke University professor, told in his book, A Whole New Life, about his battle, his 10-year battle with spinal cancer. At one point, Reynolds Price has lost the use of his arms and his legs. He is in agony, constant pain. And one day, when the pain is particularly intense and the hope of healing's particularly distant, he has a vision of being at the Sea of Galilee there with Jesus, and he is out in the water and he is naked and Jesus is baptizing him. And Price writes, "I felt the water run down the puckered scar that was my spine, and I heard the voice of Jesus say, 'My son, your sins are forgiven.' As I walked away, I thought to myself, 'But it's not my sins I'm worried about.' 'Oh yes,' Jesus said, 'that too, be healed.'" We have a list of things in our lives that we want Jesus to fix with his medical bag. We have a list of things of brokenness and violence and hurt and wounds and pains that we want Jesus to mend with his carpenter's toolbox. And all the while, what we most need is what we cannot see except in the light of his grace, the forgiveness of God. And Jesus comes to us to make us and our whole world whole. And sometimes that means our physical restoration, our physical healing. Sometimes it may mean the reconciliation of a family. Sometimes it may mean coming to peace within ourselves about who we are and what God has called us to do with our lives. Sometimes it may mean reconciliation within the church or the community, the neighborhood, the nation. Sometimes it may mean, as Paul did, that we receive the grace that is sufficient to help us struggle through. Sometimes it may mean that we will only be made whole again through death. But the healing power of God means that the restoration of our lives is about the reconciliation of all things in Jesus Christ, in heaven or on earth, in this world and in the world to come. For the Christian life is a life of abiding astonishment at the light of Jesus in one another and in this very room, in our church and in our world. As followers of Jesus, we leave this place of worship. We go out into the world to point to the light. And at first we may see the issue is right here before us, and then we find there's so much more hidden in the shadows and in the darkness that needs to be brought to the light of Christ. We may see only one dimension of a need, but God has a way of bringing every dimension of human need to the light. Sometimes I think we're like the friends who carry the paralytic to the feet of Jesus. We carry others to the feet of Jesus. We have a plan, a purpose, a program, and we persist in that difficult task until we find our way to Jesus. And even in spite of the words that we speak that are unheard, the fruitless plans that we've made, the futile efforts that we have undertaken, and just when they fall to the grounds like so much mud and straw and thatch. And even when we're willing to be just as inventive as those who dig through the roof to help a struggling child learn to read, to assist a woman who has left prison, to provide a homeless family a place to need, we find ourselves at an end place. And it is only the light of Jesus that will carry us through. Sometimes we're the ones who are carried, for we know what it is to be paralyzed and worn out and uncertain. And in those moments, we need someone to listen to us, to encourage our feeble hearts, to pick us up, to show us by her determined example the path to the light. And sometimes we're those skeptics who doubt it all, doubt every word and wonder and question, and we despair over our ministry together. We are all these things, but there's something vastly more important. There is the light of Jesus that already fills the room. It was many years ago, I remember a young naval couple in our church in Norfolk. He was a naval pilot assigned to a flight squadron on an aircraft carrier in the Mediterranean. His wife was at home expecting their first child, and after the baby was born, he was able to come home for a very quick leave and then return to the Mediterranean. Everything was so beautiful for this family, and then he gets an emergency Red Cross telegram. Come home. Robert has a tumor of unknown origin. At 3 months, their handsome baby boy, Robert, had liver cancer. For 6 months, they pursued every possible treatment. The prayers of the church carried them all to the feet of Jesus. And when we baptized Robert, the whole congregation knew that this one too, this child, was a precious child of God. But I remember the day, 3 months later, he was 6 months old, when the decision was made to disconnect the treatments and life support so that the long struggle he had endured would end. I had prayed the prayers, but I was one of the skeptics in that darkened hospital room. For months, along with countless others in the church and the community, we had prayed for his healing. I had bargained with God. I said, Lord, If you do not heal this child, no one is going to trust you. And I thought to myself, as I drove from the hospital to their home, what am I going to say to these people? My heart was broken. My faith had dried up. My words seemed hollow and useless. I was in a dark space. I went to their home and I entered the room where Robert's parents were seated on a sofa across from me. And before I let my useless words fall like so much thatch and straw and mud to the floor, they said, "If we had known what we would have to go through these last 6 months, we would do it all over again. For there has been more joy in knowing Robert than sorrow." And all along, I thought I was the one that had to bring the light to the room. And it hit me. The light was already there. We live as followers of Jesus, and we will find at times there are situations where we lead the way and we carry others to Christ. And there will also be times when we are exhausted and worn out and alone in the dark and we don't know what to do. And we will find in those moments that others will carry us. And sometimes we'll just simply shake our heads in puzzlement, thinking that we know what is of ultimate importance, only to find that we are so wrong and the important thing is something else altogether. And there will be moments when we think it all depends on us and we alone are the ones that must bring the light to the room, only to discover the light is already here. 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 In this very room. Amen.
People of God, let us stand and let us give voice to our faith as we say those ancient words of the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended to hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us once again turn our hearts to God in prayer. Almighty God, in Jesus Christ, you taught us to pray. So guide us by your Holy Spirit that our prayers may serve your will and show your love through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray for the world. God, our Creator, we pray for the world that you have made. Overthrow evil powers, right what is wrong, feed and satisfy those who thirst for justice, so that your children may freely enjoy your creation and joyfully sing your praises. And we pray for your church. Gracious God, you've called us to be the church of Jesus Christ. Keep us as one in faith and service, breaking bread together and proclaiming the good news to the world, that all may believe that you are love and turn to your ways. We pray for peace. Eternal God, you sent Jesus Christ to break down the walls of hostility that divide us. Send peace on earth and put down greed, pride, and anger, which turn nation against nation and race against race. Speed the day when wars will end and the whole world accepts your rule. We pray for those we see as enemies. O God, whom we cannot love unless we love our neighbors, remove hate and prejudice from us and from all people, so that all your children may be reconciled with those that they fear, resent, or threaten, and live together in peace. We pray for those who govern us. Mighty God, sovereign over all the nations, direct those who make, administer, and judge our laws. We pray for our president and for those in authority among us, that guided by wisdom, they may lead us in the ways of righteousness. And we pray for our world leaders. Give vision to those who serve in nations around the world and those that govern all countries, that with goodwill and justice, they may break down barriers, foster understanding, and draw the world together in peace. We pray for the sick. Merciful God, you bear the pain of the world. Look with compassion on those who are sick. Cheer them by your word and bring healing as a sign of your grace. We pray for those who sorrow as well. Stand with those who sorrow, God of comfort. Give them assurance that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come can separate them from your love. We pray for our friends and families. Bless us and those we love and our families and friends, that drawing close to you, we may also be drawn to each other. God of all generations, we praise you for your servants who have been faithful to you on earth and now live with you in heaven. Today we remember especially Hollis Taylor and Ann Sanders, and we pray for Naomi and Sandy and the rest of their families who are mourning their deaths. Keep those of us left here in fellowship together until we meet with all your children in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Mighty God, whose word we trust, whose spirit enables us to pray, accept our requests and further those that will bring about your purpose on earth and in heaven. Even as we pray as Christ taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, glory forever. Amen. And now, with joyful and generous hearts, let us offer our gifts to God.
Lewis said over and over again, the light of Christ is here. Our closing hymn says, we are the light of the world, and we've got to let our light shine. Will you please stand and join us?
Inside the dark, but that's not who we are. the world. We are the city on the hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light shine, the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine.
Let us pray. Arise, shine, your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. We thank you, O Jesus, for you are the light of the world. And so may your light fill our lives, our world, our church, that we may go forth to serve you as we commit our lives and our gifts to you. And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen.
We are the light, we are the light. So let your light shine bright. We are the light, we are the light, we are the light. Jesus, you are the light, you are the light, you are the light. We will lift you high and shine, shine, shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world.